I cannot wait to see how this is going to play out.
Oh, maybe a little nervous too. Maybe just a little bit nervous.
I mean, Eevee's right there to help calm all nerves. So how can you be nervous when there is a giant Eevee friend sitting right there with you?
All right. Well, you mentioned how and just how accomplished Justin is as a player. So let's take a look a little bit more at those accomplishments. A little bit nervous, but very excited. Look at them go. Top 8 at Worlds last year and the defending 2019 Oceania Internationals champion. I mean, wow, I've also never seen a higher number than that for regional champions.
I'm telling you, he has enough championship points to invest in his future and just qualify for Worlds many times over. And such a fun team, but we'll talk about that later. As, you know, Simone, this is her first year competing. She got top 4 at the regional championships in Malaysia. She got top 4 in the Singapore special event, which is essentially a regional championship. And this is probably her third tournament, judging by the accomplishments.
Yeah, impressive accomplishments for the very first season of play, and also running a phenomenal team. I love that we're going to have a matchup between a Glaceon and a Butterfree. It's going to be super exciting. I can't wait to see this match get underway. But if you missed it, Justin is going to be running a Dusclops, Rhyperior, Snorlax, Glaceon, Torkoal, and Indeedee. While Simone, you can see on the screen there, is going to be running that Rotom Heat, the Excadrill, Tyranitar, Whimsicott, Gyarados, and Butterfree.
Also the G-Max factor on the Butterfree, which is pretty exciting. We've seen a lot of players in the older age divisions use it for an opportunity to maybe set up some trick room or otherwise spread status on the field when they don't have another Pokemon that can take that role. And I like it. I mean, it's definitely one of those Pokemon where you have to hope that you get the right status you need at the right time. As you may not know, G-Max Befuddle, which is the name of Butterfree's G-Max move, has an equal chance of activating Paralysis, Sleep, or Burn, or Poison on the field. It can be any status, and that means you have to be prepared. You know, you have to be able to adjust. Maybe you get a Paralysis when you were really hoping for a Burn. But against Justin's team, you know, looking at the core, looking at the fact he has that Dusclops, that Rhyperior, that Snorlax, that Torkoal, that Indeedee, that is a Trick Room team.
And absolutely.
If you look at the team, you know, you can see how the Trick Room part would make sense. And you might wonder, well, why the Glaceon?
Mm-hmm.
I actually have the inside details. The Glaceon not only is one of Justin's favorite Pokemon that he was very excited about bringing to this tournament, but he was really concerned about his matchup against Pokemon like Gastrodon and Pokemon like Dragovish, which are both, you know, water-type Pokemon. Glaceon gets access to Freeze-Dry, which does super effective damage against that. So whether or not Glaceon will be on the field in this match is to be determined, but right now it looks like we're ready to get this showdown started.
Simone starting out with the Butterfree and the Tyranitar, and Justin starting out with the Dusclops and the Indeedee. Something that I'm really excited about is seeing that Indeedee set that Psychic Surge on the field.
It's going to be helpful for Justin just to block any threats of a fake out or otherwise priority moves. I think he was hoping to see that Whimsicott come out for Simone rather than the Butterfree, just because Whimsicott is the Pokemon that would be utilizing Prankster, would be using that priority that the Psychic Terrain would defend it against. The fact that Simone sent out Butterfree means that if she wants to, she can go for the Dynamax here, or Gigantamax here, and try and stop this Trick Room, but no Dynamax yet.
No, Butterfree just going to be going for that Sleep Powder, which is going to connect onto the Indeedee. Butterfree getting a chance to go for that Sleep Powder with high accuracy with a Compound Eyes. But look at this. It's going to be a Rock Slide very early on here from that Tyranitar. Oh. Dusclops flinches.
And this is how you stop Trick Room when you're facing the field across from a Follow Me user plus something like a Dusclops. You put it to sleep so that it can't go for a second Follow Me, and you hope that a flinch carries you through to the next turn. Now that Indeedee is guaranteed to be asleep this turn, this Butterfree can go ahead and target that Dusclops correctly with a second Sleep Powder. Now, Sleep Powder is not as accurate as some of the other moves that set sleep in this format, but Butterfree does have access to an ability called Compound Eyes, which will raise that accuracy. It's still not 100%, but it makes it a much more reliable strategy for situations just like this.
Well, that's going to force the Indeedee to come back to Justin and Rhyperior to come out in its place. Oh, usually what we would consider a risky move, but Justin's considered a bit behind, but the Sleep Powder's going to connect onto the Dusclops again. If Justin was trying to go for a Trick Room, it can't go for that anymore.
And Tyranitar gets another Rock Slide into boot.
Yeah, wow. We won't even know whether or not that flinched, but it doesn't even matter. Dusclops is going to be fast asleep, was attempting to go for some type of move.
I wonder what Simone's going to do now, though. I think the Butterfree is safe to stay in and go for another Sleep Powder against that Rhyperior. We know it's going to be faster, but Tyranitar really needs to find a way to start dealing some damage. If it has access to a move like Crunch, attacking that Dusclops now might mean between the Crunch damage and the Sandstorm damage, it knocks it out. And then Justin won't have access to Trick Room for the rest of the game. But hey, if you're worried about damage output, why not Dynamax your Pokemon and just do a little bit extra on top of that?
Well, Tyranitar with the sand set and no threat of that Trick Room for a while. Tyranitar will go for that Dynamax factor, and it's going to be larger than life on the field with Butterfree as its supporter by its side. Rhyperior going for the Protect just in case Tyranitar decides to go for a move into that slot or the Sleep Powder from the Butterfree, so Rhyperior will get a chance to protect itself, but a Max Darkness is going to go right into the Dusclops and knock it out. No more Trick Room available for this game one.
It's possible that, you know, Justin can find a way to win this game without the access to Trick Room, but he needs to find a way to stop this Butterfree from using Sleep Powder. Eventually, the Sandstorm damage could knock it out, but that's not going to happen in enough of a time frame. I think what Justin needs to do is either hope that this Indeedee will wake up. This is after that mandatory turn of sleep. It will be able to, if it can wake up, maybe it can go for something like a Follow Me to redirect the Sleep Powder away. Or just hope that this Rhyperior can find a way to, you know, weather these next few turns. Tyranitar doesn't have access to many moves that can hit that Rhyperior super effectively, and Simone might want to avoid that entirely given how many Rhyperior on Trick Room teams like to run something like Weakness Policy. So well, Justin still has a way to win this game, but without Trick Room, it's just going to be that much harder.
It's going to be a little bit harder, but Justin has to go for something here. Is going to take their chances by Dynamaxing the Rhyperior and seeing what they can get done outside of that Trick Room. More importantly, going to have access to double the HP, and Indeedee, unfortunately, still going to be asleep for this turn. Butterfree going for the Sleep Powder.
It does connect
into the Rhyperior, so Rhyperior going fastly to sleep after using all of that energy to Dynamax. Tyranitar now, Max Rockfall. Let's see what it connects with. Will be that Indeedee, and with that such low HP, that's going to be an easy knockout for Simone.
To Justin's benefit, because the Butterfree moved before the Rhyperior had an option to attack, this was the turn of mandatory sleep. So Rhyperior does have a chance that it could wake up next turn, but again, that is just a chance. The thing about Butterfree that makes it so scary is that if you don't have a way to mitigate sleep or status, you know, you get into these situations where Butterfree is naturally faster than these Pokemon and can connect these sleep powders left and right. You know, Justin, I think he has a decent setup, again, to just try and stay in this. The Dynamax on the Tyranitar will expire after this turn, and Torkoal and Rhyperior are more than capable to knock out these Pokemon if given the opportunity, but he needs to go back to the drawing board and ensure that Butterfree just doesn't get these openings to just use Sleep Powder after Sleep Powder after Sleep Powder.
I think every Pokemon on Justin's side has gotten a chance to take a little bit of a nap here, but this Max Knuckle right into this Rhyperior is going to be super effective. And sure, it's going to boost the attack onto Simone's side of the field, but we'll see whether or not that Rhyperior is carrying that Weakness Policy, and there it is.
If Rhyperior wakes up this turn, that could be huge.
Oh, Rhyperior woke up!
Dead!
Rhyperior woke up, going to get a chance to use a move, and it's going to be that Max Rockfall right into the Butterfree. Butterfree going to get knocked out. No more sleep for this game either.
Yeah, I don't think Rhyperior needed the extra damage from that Weakness Policy for that KO, but it is going to be such a powerful Pokemon for Justin now that it has managed to wake up. If it can connect an attack with this Tyranitar, especially after the Dynamax expires, it will most likely be a KO. Simone's going to have a Pokemon in the back that can really handle this Rhyperior very easily in order to win this game. You know, Gyarados is certainly a good Pokemon to start with. It does get access to Levitate, or it is Levitating because it's a Flying-type Pokemon, so it won't be able to take damage from Ground-type attacks, but if Rhyperior goes for a second Rockfall, you know, that's going to be some super effective damage on it. The Intimidate does work in her favor, but she might have to switch this Gyarados out, try to get a second Intimidate down onto that Rhyperior so that the Weakness Policy isn't boosting its attack so sky-high.
We'll see if that Gyarados does switch out, but instead it's going to go for a Protect. Simone wants to leave it on the field. Tyranitar also going for Protect just to stall out some of these Dynamax turns from Justin and also some of the damage that's going to be coming out from these Max moves. So here's that Max Rock Ball. Wasn't quite sure which Pokemon it was going to connect with, but it was going to be the Gyarados,
so,
and that's so powerful. Even with the Protect, it does so much damage. Torkoal stays asleep this turn.
Unfortunately, though, if Simone decides she wants to try and stall out the Dynamax on the Rhyperior, that is another turn of sleep that is stalled out for Justin. So now that Rhyperior has returned to its original size, you know, this might actually be a benefit for Justin. Assuming the Rock-type attack that that Rhyperior has access to is Rock Slide, now that it is not Dynamax, it can easily target the Gyarados and the Tyranitar at the same time, do enough damage to pick up the KO on the Gyarados, do a little bit of damage to the Tyranitar, and then just hope that the Torkoal...
Look at that! That's so much damage from the Waterfall. Rhyperior didn't even stand a chance. Tyranitar gets a chance to go for the Rock Slide as well. Torkoal not going to be able to take that either. Simone taking game one.
What a way to end that game. You know, Gyarados is one of those Pokemon that, at least in the Masters division, you most commonly see with an item like an Assault Vest, and it usually isn't trained to take those big KOs. Instead, it's trained a little bit more defensively. That's probably an indication that Simone, you know, trained this Gyarados to be a counter to Rhyperior. That Waterfall was able to pick up the KO from about 75% on a normal-sized Rhyperior. So that is great information for her to know going into this game too, because looking at Justin's strategy, if he does decide to go with Trick Room again, I think that Rhyperior is still going to be a very tempting option. He does have access to the G-Max Snorlax that we saw on the team slide and with his accomplishments earlier, and that could be an adjustment for him, but that still is going to rely on Trick Room. He needs to find a way to break through the Butterfree, not just have his Pokemon be put to sleep before they can go for the Trick Room. And then once he has that speed advantage, you know, Rhyperior, Snorlax, Torkoal, all these very powerful, slow Pokemon will be able to pick up the momentum they need. But again, how do you avoid the sleep powder?
Oh, I'm so impressed with the way that Simone played those first couple of turns in that game one, because it completely denied the Trick Room that Justin was trying to get set up. But I would also say that towards the mid to late game, Justin ended up pivoting and piloting the team expertly well to try to give themselves a chance in that matchup. Even around the sleep, they were capable of doing damage to that Butterfree and just removing that option entirely from Simone.
And I'm glad you mentioned that, because I think the way that Justin should pivot going into this game is identical to how he pivoted in the middle of game one.
Right.
Don't lead your Trick Room Pokemon. If you lead something like, I don't know, maybe Rhyperior or Torkoal, you could Rock Slide and maybe Eruption, and then you get two attacks off, the Butterfree's not going to be able to dodge both of them, and that should be the damage you need in order to pick up that KO, and then you can send Dusclops in later to set up that Trick Room. So I really like how Justin, like you said, recognized the fact that he needed to adjust his strategy in the middle of the game. And I think that gave himself a really good opening towards the end. I think he just needs to try and make that adjustment for this lead as well.
Well, it's going to be a bit of an interesting switch up here from Justin. No longer going to put the Dusclops on the field, but instead bringing the Rhyperior and the Indeedee. Like that game one, the Indeedee is going to be back. And for Simone, same leads as game one, that Tyranitar as well as that Butterfree.
But with the Indeedee next to the Rhyperior, the Indeedee can still go for a Follow Me, take the Sleep Powder away from the Butterfree, and then that Rhyperior is free to go on the offensive. Again,
absolutely,
all it's going to take is one of these Rock Slides to knock out that Butterfree.
Yeah, Butterfree commonly ends up carrying something like a
Focus Sash.
So that's a possibility here. But with this sand up, that's a very difficult place for Simone to be in if it is indeed carrying that Focus Sash. But Justin's going on the offensive. Rhyperior is going to Dynamax turn one of this game, larger than life, and making sure that this Butterfree's not going to be a big threat if it decides to target it down.
Also, with the Tyranitar not Dynamaxing, that Rhyperior should be around for more than a few turns. You know, Tyranitar, again, is not known to be dealing big damage to a Pokemon like Rhyperior.
Wow, Butterfree classically going for that Sleep Powder, and Indeedee taking that one on the chin in Rhyperior's stead. Tyranitar going for the Rock Slide, but Rhyperior avoids the attack. Rhyperior is going to get a chance to fire off an attack, even though that does about half health to the Indeedee. Max Rock Fall will be targeting down this Butterfree, and that's going to be a clean one-hit knockout. No Focus Sash there.
So that's an interesting thing to note. You have to wonder what that Butterfree is holding. We might be able to get back to it in game three, but for now, Justin has managed to get rid of the Pokemon that caused him so much trouble in game one. You know, I think that even though the speed on the field is still in Simone's favor, and this Gyarados is something that Justin really has to be careful around. You know, we saw Gyarados get the KO onto that Rhyperior after the Dynamax had expired. So at full health, you imagine that this Rhyperior should be able to take at least one attack from this Gyarados. Simone could always choose to Dynamax the Gyarados on her side of the field itself. You know, there also is an Intimidate in play. We haven't seen the weakness policy activate on that Rhyperior yet, but, you know, Justin has found a way to just really completely change the board state from the beginning of this game, too.
Yeah, Justin's in such a good position right now, and Simone going for the Dynamax. We'll have to wait and see what she decided to Dynamax. It's actually going to be the Tyranitar, not the Gyarados. And I actually think this is like a really good position for Simone to be in as well. It's going to be threatening quite a bit of damage to either of the Pokemon on the field.
And it resists most of the attacks that the Rhyperior has as well. Ooh. So if the Rhyperior targeted this Gyarados, that's a perfect opening for this Tyranitar.
Indeed, he's still fast asleep. Tyranitar is going to move first with the Max Knuckle.
Oh,
the Max Knuckle is going to go right into the Rhyperior. And yes, it does. It will activate that weakness policy because of that super effective damage.
Gyarados will get an attack boost from that, though. Maybe that's what Simone needs in order to threaten this Rhyperior. Speed is still on her side. If she can attack with it the next turn, then that's, again, an opening.
Well, we saw how much this Max Rockfall did, even through the Protect. It's still going to be able to hang on, but it does even more damage than the last time we saw that move.
And it looks like this Gyarados is going to be within knockout range from the Sandstorm damage the next turn if this Rhyperior has something like a Max Guard. Now might be a good time for Justin to use it. You know, I love how he's changed up his strategy there. I think that this Rhyperior doesn't necessarily need Trick Room in order to excel in this matchup. And I think that's what's so cool about Justin's team and his playstyle right now.
Simone feels a little bit threatened by that Rhyperior at the moment, so a bit interesting adjustment on their part as well. Will be bringing in that Rotom Heat, but another Max Knuckle from this Tyranitar is going to be going into the Rhyperior again, just trying to chip away at that damage, knowing that there's no threat of that weakness policy being procced again, because it's already there.
And the Tyranitar is at plus two attack itself now, but if Rhyperior targets this Max Quake into that Tyranitar, that's going to be some big damage.
Barely hangs on.
And Indeedee, I mean, it should be about time for Indeedee to wake up. Usually sleep only lasts for four turns, and I believe this was that turn. Oh.
What is
plus
this?
Plus two attack, my bad. I meant to say plus four. That's a weakness policy on that Tyranitar.
That is a weakness policy there on that Tyranitar, and unfortunately, it will be able to take advantage of that next turn, but it's still super low in terms of its health pool.
It is. It will only need one hit to knock it out, but the combination of the Rotom and the Tyranitar dealing damage next turn, I mean, a Rock Slide would certainly knock out Indeedee from that range, and you have to imagine it'd be dealing some big damage to that Rhyperior, or Max Rockfall, excuse me. You know, so I think as long as Simone is able to target the Pokemon that she wants to in the next turn, or at least play around the fact that this Indeedee most likely will wake up and go for a follow me here, you know, she's still in a good spot, but this is Justin's opportunity to make a comeback.
Justin's Indeedee going for the follow me, but the Rotom using Ally Switch!
Oh no!
Oh no! Is this going to catch Justin off guard? Because Tyranitar going for the Max Knuckle at that plus of four will be going into the Indeedee just to make sure that it gets knocked out from the follow me there. Okay.
No, that Tyranitar is at plus five.
But yeah, that Tyranitar is at plus five.
Tyranitar.
Rhyperior going for the Rock Slide though. Didn't get caught by the Ally Switch at all. Gets the double knockout.
Where there is a Rock Slide, there is a way. Being able to attack both the Pokemon there and recognizing the threat of the Ally Switch from
Rotom
just really paying off for Justin. Simone is down to her last Pokemon in the form of that Gyarados. And unfortunately for Gyarados, even though the Intimidate will bring that Rhyperior back down to neutral attack, Glaceon has one purpose on Justin's team other than being his favorite Pokemon. It's to deal super effective damage to water-type Pokemon like Gyarados. So Justin doing an amazing job of recognizing that he didn't need Trick Room in this matchup and able to pick up the KO on that Gyarados and bring us into a game three.
We have been rewarded with two Game 3 sets so far for the Championship Sunday of the 2020 Pokémon Oceania International Championships. It all comes down to this last game again.
And it is going to be a really interesting game because I think Simone was hoping to see, you know, another Trick Room setup from Justin there. I love the Tyranitar and the Butterfree working together, but I don't think she was able to utilize the Butterfree as effectively as she had in past games, just because Justin was able to play around the threat of the Sleep Powder. And unfortunately, I think Butterfree is a Pokemon that, you know, you want to be as disruptive as possible, and as a result, if you can't go for those Sleep Powders, if your Pokemon gets knocked out within the early turns of the game, you know, it might be better to leave it behind. You know, I love the Gyarados and the Tyranitar and the Rotom Heat on her team, even though we only saw the ally switch reveal from Rotom. I think if she decides to leave Butterfree behind and maybe bring a Pokemon like that Excadrill that we saw in Team Preview, you know, that would be enough power on her side of the field to sort of play around Justin's strategy, regardless if he decides to go for Trick Room or not. That being said, though, you know, Justin definitely has an advantage going into this team preview just because, you know, he does have the option of running Trick Room or going for a Trick Room-less strategy. And given the powerful Pokemon that he has on his side of the field with that Rhyperior, that Glaceon, you know, those are going to be things that Simone really has to be careful about. And I think that's why a strategy like Justin's, you know, that relies so heavily on Trick Room can be successful in this format. You do need to know how to position yourself and know how to play it correctly. But, you know, Justin, you know, he's a champion. He's the incoming Oceania International champion. He knows how to play that positioning. And, you know, I can't wait to see how these trainers are going to approach this game three because they've been playing so incredibly well so far.
I mean, I think the adjustments that Justin made in that game two really speak to the level of trainer that they are. I mean, it just kind of backs up the resume, right? But alongside that, Simone, their first season playing Pokemon has shown us some incredible heads up play as well in terms of that game one, just ensuring that that Trick Room wasn't going to be a threat. But here we go with this game three. It's about time
right,
we get it underway.
Go.
And it's going to be a similar strategy to what we saw in game two. Justin feels like that was the play, and that's what's going to work, and Simone's still confident in that strategy as well.
Yeah, it makes you wonder what Simone has in mind. I don't think you go for the Sleep Powder onto the Indeedee here unless you're planning on trying to keep Butterfree safe in another way. Of course, this Tyranitar has access to Rock Slide, and we did see a flinch come into play early on in game one. But if Justin decides to Dynamax that Rhyperior, it will not be able to flinch. So I think she has to learn from what she saw in game one and assume that if it is going to be a follow me followed by a Dynamax, you have to keep that Butterfree safe for later when Dynamax isn't an option. But it looks like the adjustment was made, and it's actually Whimsicott coming out for her.
Interesting play here.
And a Dynamax as well.
Yeah, we are going to see a turn one Dynamax, which is different than what we saw in game two. So going right away on the offensive, but also preserving that Butterfree for later in case there is something like a Trick Room setter in the back for Justin. But Whimsicott being on the field is going to be able to take some of these attacks just a little bit better. But Justin's going for the Dynamax as well, and we can only make an educated guess as to what this Pokemon's going to be.
It's indeed, no, it's actually Rhyperior. Just kidding. But no, I think Rhyperior is definitely one of the Pokemon that you want to be consistently Dynamaxing in this format. It's just so good.
Absolutely. We've seen how powerful this Rhyperior can be when it gets a chance to go for the weakness policy. But Indeedee, follow me. It wants to be that center of attention. It's going to take this Max Knuckle really well.
But that won't activate the weakness policy on the Rhyperior, which I think is the key thing to notice here. And hypothetically, if this Rhyperior targeted that Butterfree slot, it's now a Whimsicott. So really just an interesting sort of turn of events. I'm not quite sure what this Whimsicott is going to do. I think with the combination of that damage and the Sandstorm that's currently active on the field, it's mostly there to protect the Butterfree. But this is a really interesting opportunity for Simone. Her Tyranitar is at plus one attack. The Indeedee is within range of a KO from a second attack. Maybe you send in the Gyarados, get a nice Intimidate down, protect. Maybe you send in the Butterfree, and you know we've only seen it use Sleep Powder. If it has access to another attack that can KO the Indeedee, it's possible that a plus one Max Knuckle from that Tyranitar will deal some big damage to the Rhyperior.
Well, Indeedee is going to use Follow Me again, just trying to protect its partner Rhyperior for another turn. But Butterfree will unfortunately be going to use that Sleep Powder right into the Indeedee, putting it to sleep. And now it's time for Tyranitar to make a move. Max Knuckle again, but because this Indeedee ended up utilizing that Follow Me, it's going to have to take that Max Knuckle, and it will get the knockout and the attack boost, but Rhyperior is free to make another attack.
It's free to make another attack with the Tyranitar that plus two. If the Rhyperior targets that Tyranitar with an attack, it's the possibility of a weakness policy.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I like how Justin went for the KO on Butterfree here again. You know, it caused him so much trouble in game one. I think that just removing it from the field and really bringing Simone down to her last two Pokemon is key to his strategy moving forwards. That being said, you know, speed is currently still in Simone's favor. You know, it's true that Justin has that Glaceon against the Gyarados on his side of the field, but that Tyranitar is still at full health as well. So Simone, even though she is down to her last two Pokemon, you know, she certainly has a ton of options here to play out the field. Dynamax is going to expire for that Rhyperior in one more turn. So if she can maybe stall out the remainder of Dynamax, find a way to remove that Glaceon on the field before it can threaten her Gyarados too much, you know, she might be able to find an opening here. We don't know what Justin's last Pokemon is. If it's something like that Torkoal, without Trick Room, you know, it's going to be KO'd quite easily by this Tyranitar.
Well, protect first from the Gyarados. Glaceon going for the Ice Shard.
Oh, to
but
activate
right
the
into the Rhyperior to activate the weakness policy. That was a side Ice Shard.
That was so smart of Justin.
Wow, and preserving that knowledge for this game three, Max Knuckle right into the Rhyperior. Is it going to be enough to knock it out?
No.
So that weakness policy is procced, and Rhyperior is going to get a chance to attack.
I mean, we've seen this Max Rockfall deal so much damage through the Protect onto that Gyarados. It's most likely going to be within range of Ice Shard knocking it out again after this big attack. Okay, a little less damage than last time, but still, Ice Shard priority attack with the Sandstorm damage, it probably will be enough. And just like that, you know, Simone's Dynamax has expired, and the Rhyperior's Dynamax has expired. You know, we are getting down to the wire, and these next couple of turns, it's possible even this turn will determine who is our junior Oceania International Champion.
Tyranitar still is faster than the Rhyperior, and it does have a couple of those attack boosts, so it's not over quite yet, but that Glaceon's threatening a lot onto that Gyarados.
And that Tyranitar still has a weakness policy of its own.
Yeah, it does. It will not be activated quite yet. Glaceon going for the Ice Shard right into the Gyarados. It's just going to be normal damage, so it's not going to be too much, but the Power Whip actually goes into the Glaceon.
Does a little bit of damage.
Yeah, a good read, though, by Simone to go for the Glaceon instead of the Rhyperior, absolutely. Citrus Berry to restore a lot of that power, but Super Power right into the Rhyperior. Rhyperior going to protect itself, and Gyarados getting buffeted by that Sandstorm makes it
not
so
enough to
low.
Knock it out.
It still hangs on, though.
But Simone could decide to protect it here, which will give her Tyranitar another opportunity to attack. I mean, Justin can try and predict that, but if he doubles into that Tyranitar and the Gyarados doesn't protect, that can be huge as well. So Simone is definitely still within this game, and that Tyranitar is still a big threat to Justin.
But the Glaceon going for the Ice Shard is going to knock out the Gyarados before it's able to do another attack this turn. It's just a Tyranitar left, but it's going for a Rock Slide.
All right, let's
we'll see,
see
whether
how
or not
this
it gets
does.
The punches. Ooh, well, Glaceon's going to get knocked out here. Rhyperior not super effective, but we'll see whether or not I can get an attack off.
I think the flinch is what you have to hope for here. If
you're
Simone,
no, it uses the Rock
miss,
Slide.
Or a miss.
No miss here. Tyranitar is going to have to take that one, but Tyranitar still gets a chance to attack one more time. Let's see what this last Pokemon is for Justin.
If it is that Torkoal, a Rock Slide with the attack boost on that Tyranitar should be enough to pick up that knockout, which means Rhyperior could
Stuff
be
pops.
Close. But instead, knowing that Justin's last Pokemon is going to be the Dusclops, Simone has a very difficult decision. She can go for a Dark-type attack into that Dusclops and pick up the KO, but then Rhyperior is free to knock out her Tyranitar. If Justin doesn't protect the Rhyperior and she misses the opportunity to attack into it, that could be huge. Here we go.
Tyranitar
she
uses Crunch.
Protect.
She
called
the Protect.
Gets
and
the KO.
Gets the knockout.
Simone reading that perfectly, predicting casting that Protect on the Rhyperior, and she just needs to find a way to knock out this Rhyperior, and she will be the next champion. This is down to the absolute wire.
Tyranitar going for the superpower right into the Rhyperior,
and
it's enough to get the knockout. Congratulations to Simone, our next Oceania International Champion.
The crowd is going wild, but Simone is just there happily smiling, getting a hug from her friend. Congratulations to both of these trainers. It came down to the absolute wire.
Training sets we've ever seen in juniors history. First of all, Simone, congratulations. How do you feel?
Happy.
Happy indeed. You played so well. You didn't give in to the pressure. Were you nervous after the first or after you lost that second round?
I was nervous after I lost the second round.
But you played so well in that final game. You made the prediction to go for the crunch onto Dusclops. How did you know that was the right play to make?
Because I know that he's going to protect the Rhyperior.
You were right. He protected the Rhyperior, and you got the knockout. You know, you played so well. I think you were a fan favorite. Everyone was just so happy to see you perform well. So, you know, do you have any thank yous to say to the people that were supporting you?
Well, my friends and my family and my coach.
I'm sure they're all very, very proud of you. Truly a tremendous performance, and you have so many fans out there supporting you. So Simone, congratulations once again on an amazing victory. Is there anything else you'd like to say?
No.
All right, you heard it from the champion herself. Thank you guys, and when we're back, we'll be back here with the Masters Finals.